Hello and welcome back to this series of videos on memory. This video focuses on conscious memory, the sort of memory that we can call to mind. This presentation is built on material in my last video, the first in this series on memory. So if you have not yet seen that video, I recommend that you do so before viewing this one. Recall that our last video ended with a problem. The problem of how memories stored in different regions of the brain get together. For example, our memories of apple involve not just appearance, but also taste, touch, eating sounds, and aromatic smells. And our memories of mother involve all sorts of different things. We know that brain impulses travel slowly, and that different types of sensory information get processed in different regions. So how do all these memories get tied together seamlessly within the conscious mind? This whole matter clearly cries out for coordination. Fortunately, at least in regard to so-called declarative memories, those we can consciously call to mind, we have a fair idea of where the coordination happens and how it works. The principal coordinator for establishing new declarative memory is a small elongated brain structure called the hippocampus. The name means seahorse in Latin, and if you apply some imagination, you can see that the hippocampus looks a bit like a seahorse, with one end running under the temporal lobe and the other curling up and around a central brain coordinator called the thalamus. We know that the hippocampus and adjacent parts of the temporal lobe play a critical part in establishing our consciously recallable declarative memories. That's because certain people who have damaged these areas on both sides of the brain, or who have had them removed, people we call amnesics, cannot form new declarative memory. Their working memory circuits in the prefrontal lobe, circuits that set up very brief memories lasting from a few seconds to a few minutes, are usually working fine. So you could chat with such an amnesic and he might seem perfectly normal. But if you left the room and came back 10 minutes later, he would remember neither his visitor nor the visit. He would be like an insect in amber, trapped in his own past, unable to establish pathways for consciously recalling any new memories dating from the time that the two hippocampi were damaged or removed. This regrettable fate befalls many victims of Alzheimer's disease, which has a penchant for damaging the hippocampus. Well then, what gives the little hippocampus the power to establish conscious memories? The hippocampus is too small to serve as a storehouse for all these recallable memories, but it has a couple of features that provide important clues. First, it is well connected. Indeed, if the brain were British high society, the hippocampus would be as well connected as the Duke of York. Recall, for starters, that sensory and other brain processing is not entirely regional. As this processing becomes more and more advanced, it moves from specialized regional areas into what are known as association areas of the cerebral cortex. The hippocampus is well connected with these association areas. It also has strong ties to the prefrontal cortex that is intimately involved with thought, emotions, and working memory. It has close ties to the amygdala, a leading coordinator of emotion. And it has intimate ties to the thalamus, a prime coordinator of consciousness. I will have more to say about the thalamus in the videos on consciousness. For the moment, however, we are focusing on the hippocampus. So it is worth noting that besides its influential connections, the hippocampus has another interesting feature. That is, the neurons of the hippocampus are highly sensitive, prone to strengthening or weakening their synaptic connections easily. The hippocampus uses this feature to connect to neural pathways conveying new information. So the hippocampus receives highly processed information from a wide range of advanced processing areas, forges connections to this information, and in so doing connects the information to mechanisms in the thalamus or elsewhere that are responsible for coordinating consciousness. This gets rid of the regional processing problem because connections are formed via the hippocampus between the simultaneous or nearly simultaneous sights, sounds, emotions, thoughts, and so forth being processed in different parts of the brain that are tied to a given relevant event. In this way, a more or less chronologic record is formed of significant events or episodes. And since this record is also tied into the mechanisms responsible for consciousness, the conscious mind can use this so-called episodic record in order to retrieve chronologic or episodic memories. But what's easy to do is also easy to undo. These hippocampal connections are fleeting. So for purposes of preservation, these episodic connections to events deemed to be important are moved out of the hippocampus into other parts of the brain, especially into nearby parts of the temporal lobe. That is a good thing, because the hippocampus and even the entire brain lacks the space to store a connective chronological record of everything that happened to you from early childhood onward. So it's not surprising to find that some of our less important episodic memories soon fade, either because they were not moved out of the hippocampus, or because they got overwritten, or because they deteriorated for lack of use, or perhaps for other reasons. That's why you can probably recall with fair accuracy the events of breakfast this morning, but will have a tougher time recalling the events of breakfast on some specific day, last week, last month, or last year. Within this context, we know that traumatic memories flagged with high emotions, like memories of a traffic accident, tend to be preserved mostly through hardwired connections set up by the amygdala. And we also know that memories can be preserved through repetition. Suppose you saw your first robin at age 5. For a time, you may have recalled this sighting as an episodic memory, but then you saw another robin, and another, and since then you have seen thousands. Many of these sightings were briefly recorded as episodic, but most of the episodic circumstances of those sightings soon faded, while the initially episodic memories about robins haven't, because the repeated robin sightings have kept them strong. You can now say, "I know a not robin when I see one," even though your event-related memories of most specific robin sightings are long gone. So your robin memory has changed. The connections you used to recall it were presumably set up by the hippocampal system, but most of the episodic connections have faded out. This consciously recallable robin memory is still declarative memory because you can consciously recall and state or declare it, but it no longer relates to specific episodes, so it's no longer episodic. Instead, it is what the experts call semantic memory. Most of the memory we can consciously recall is semantic memory. We all know that airplanes fly, fish swim, and horses run, even though we cannot remember where we learned any of those things. But our hippocampal systems have been working a long time to establish episodic connections that then become increasingly semantic. So it seems reasonable to conclude that our far-flung hippocampal systems play a large role in establishing and reinforcing our consciously recallable semantic memory. But the same is not true of procedural memory, the vast collection of skills we can summon consciously. They work very differently and they get fixed in memory differently. It is as though the consciousness system had an inbox for recalling memories to mind and an outbox for consciously ordering up procedures. This latter procedural memory is the subject of our next video.